Dear listeners and viewers, my name is Dick Harrison. I am professor of history at Lund University. Here I describe in 7 tableaux how Sweden has developed in the last 200 years, from having been one of Europe's poorest countries to become one of the richest. This remarkable story had its symbolic beginnings in 1810, when a French marshal arrived in Sweden. He was born in Pau in 1763, and his name was Jean-Baptiste Jules Bernadotte. As successor to the Swedish throne, he adopted the name Karl Johan, Charles John, and as king of both Sweden and Norway, he has gone down in history as Karl the 14th Johan. His career is one of the most extraordinary in history. In 1810, when Jean-Baptiste Bernadotte was elected King of Sweden, the country was in one of its deepest crises ever. The whole of eastern Sweden, today's Finland, had been lost to Russia. The old regime had been deposed. The economy was at rock bottom. The intention behind the choice of Bernadotte was that, with his solid experience, he would arouse Sweden and make the country strong again. Few royal elections in the history of Europe have been turned out to be so fortunate in retrospect. Not only did Bernadotte get Sweden back on its feet, sort out the economy, create a union with Norway, and begin a period of peace never before seen in world history, he also founded a dynasty that still occupies the throne of Sweden. The House of Bernadotte has ruled Sweden longer than any of the nation's previous dynasties, and it has kept up with the times. Karl XIV Johan's son, Oscar I, who reigned between 1844 and 1859, was an active king who supported pioneering liberal reforms, including the abolition of slavery in St. Barthélemy, granting women the same inheritance rights as men, and introducing freedom of trade. His son, Karl XV, was an outgoing king with a common touch, who travelled around the country, was a skilled landscape painter, and became immensely popular among ordinary Swedes, even though his political influence was less than that of his predecessors. The same can be said of the monarchs who followed, Oscar II and Gustav V. Although they were concerned about the increasingly rapid transformation of society, they became symbols of Sweden, both inwards and outwards. Whereas many other dynasties collapsed in wars and revolutions at the start of the 20th century, the House of Bernadotte survived by adapting to the changed rules of the political game. When democracy was finally introduced with universal suffrage for men and women in the years from 1909 to 1921, there was never any talk of the monarchy being replaced by a republic. Gustav VI Adolf, who ascended the throne in 1950 and reigned until his death at the age of 90 in 1973, was a king with a strong sense of duty who never deviated from the role assigned to him by the constitution. He loyally adapted to the political realities and made a point of being an advisor to the government rather than its head. The Social Democrat Tage Erlander, who was Prime Minister for 23 years, was initially skeptical about the king, but quickly changed his mind and collaborated well with him. A relevant factor is that Gustav VI Adolf had great scholarly interests, which brought respect in the surrounding world. He was a knowledgeable and enthusiastic archaeologist who took part in excavations in Sweden and abroad, not least of all in Italy. He gained an honorary doctorate and became an honorary member of many academies. Alongside this, he built up an impressive collection of East Indian porcelain, which is now in the possession of the Museum of Far Eastern Antiquities in Stockholm. And he transformed the park of Sofiero Castle outside Helsingborg into a garden dream with valleys filled with rhododendron. But the Swedish history of the Bernadotte dynasty is much greater than that of its kings. Alongside the monarchs and crown princes, the many princes and princesses of the royal house have made major contributions, both cultural and political. Every pupil who has just graduated from high school in Sweden has sung the student song, written by Prince Gustav, who died prematurely in 1852. The prince's sister, Eugénie, was active as a composer and an artist, but she was above all interested in medical care, helping to establish nursing homes and children's homes. Her most famous initiative was the Eugenia Home in Stockholm, which was intended for the care of incurably sick children. Oscar II's wife, Queen Sophia, who met and was inspired by Florence Nightingale, took the initiative for Sophia Hemmet in Stockholm, a hospital where nurses have been trained since 1884. Sweden's present Queen Silvia has expanded the work of the hospital to comprise the training of Silvia's sisters, experts in dementia care. Prince Eugen, brother of Gustav V, was a central figure in Swedish artistic life at the end of the 19th century and the start of the 20th. His own works are a part of the Swedish cultural heritage and can be seen in several public settings. Prince Eugen's home, with its art collections in Stockholm, Valdemarsudde, was bequeathed to the state and is today one of Sweden's prime museums. Gustav VI Adolf's first wife, Crown Princess Margareta, was a skillful painter and landscape gardener. Sigvard Bernadotte, son of Gustav VI Adolf, was one of its time's leading Swedish industrial designers. Count Folke Bernadotte, who belonged to a side branch of the royal house, headed the Swedish Red Cross, and at the end of the Second World War, he led several rescue actions in Germany. Thanks to his personal diplomacy, he succeeded in bringing more than 20,000 men and women from German concentration camps to Sweden in the famous White Buses. A few years later, in May 1948, Folke Bernadotte was appointed to mediate for the United Nations in the conflict in Palestine. These efforts ended in tragedy. Bernadotte literally gave his life to broker peace. On the 17th of September in 1948, he was murdered in Jerusalem by the Israeli Stern Gang. Instead of impeding development, the Bernadotte dynasty has thus for 200 years been intimately associated with Sweden's development towards democracy and prosperity. Sweden's present king, Carl XVI Gustav, represents a solid tradition of peaceful political cooperation and a positive attitude to economic and technical change, while simultaneously displaying a keen interest in agriculture and the environment. Unsurprisingly, when he ascended the throne in 1973, he chose the motto, "For Sweden with the Time."